Good morning. It's good to see you today, this second Sunday of the new year and first Sunday of our new sermon series, as Sua mentioned a moment ago. I'm just going to ask us to join together in prayer, and we'll jump right into it today. God, you've blessed us once again by allowing us to be here today. We take every day as a gift from you. And Lord, as we've gathered here this morning and been led in worship, been reminded of who you are, of your incredible love for us that never fails. Now, God, we gather to hear from you regarding what you have to say to us from your word. And we know your word is truth, and we know we're desperate for truth. And so I just pray now, Lord, that as we look into the first chapter of the book of Luke, this account of the life of Jesus Christ, you will open our eyes and our hearts to the truth that you have for us today. Show us how you want to apply that truth. Help us, Lord, to be open to receive it. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Now, I know most of us are familiar with the Bible, and you've got two halves to it. You've got the Old Testament as God's dealing with his people, the Israelites, and you've got the New Testament, which is primarily the life of Jesus Christ and then the church. And if you were to jump into the New Testament and say, you know, I just want to read through the New Testament and start off, and you'd come right away to a biography of this man, Jesus Christ. It's written by a guy named Matthew, and you could read through it and say, great, now I've read about the life of Jesus, let's move on to something else. And you'd turn the page and you'd find, oh no, there's another biography there of the life of Jesus written by a different individual named Mark, and you could read through that and learn a couple new things, and then you'd be ready to go. But again, you would run into another, and actually there are four distinct biographies of the life of Jesus at the beginning of the New Testament. Now, I don't know if you've ever wondered why. Why would God design the Bible that way? Why would he design his word for us with four biographies at the beginning of the New Testament, four biographies of the same person? Well, I believe it is simply this, that our God is a God who chooses to reveal himself to us. He does not choose to conceal himself from us. And so God knows how important it is for us to understand this person, Jesus Christ, God the Son, arguably the most important individual of all of human history. So he wants four separate perspectives from four different people on the life and the ministry of this man, Jesus Christ. It's that important. And if you want to look at it from more of a macro level, the entire Bible is God revealing himself to us. He wants us to know him. He does not want to conceal himself from us. Last Sunday, if you were here, Pastor Peter got up here and he invited all of us to join together on a journey for the next several months into one of these biographies of the life of Jesus Christ, and that is written by this man named Luke. And that's what we are embarking on today. We're going to start in the first chapter, but before we do, just a few words of background as to how we got to this point and why we selected the Gospel of Luke. I don't know if any of you are familiar with the author James Michener, some of you that are more of my generation. I see a few heads nodding out there. Michener was one of the top-selling authors of a generation ago, multiple books on the New York Times bestseller list, and he wrote novels that were based in a particular location. And he has novels about Japan, Hawaii, Texas, Chesapeake, and multiple others. And what Michener would do is he would actually relocate to the place he was writing about. So if he was writing about Chesapeake Bay, for example, one of his novels, he would move there. He would settle there. He would spend time talking to the people. He would learn about the culture. He would learn about the history. And then he would start writing his novel, and he would write it on location. So when you read one of his novels, it is just full of detail about that location. I call Luke, the author of this biography, the James Michener of the New Testament, because he drills down into details that none of the other gospel writers do. It is the longest of the four gospels because it contains more information, more color, if you will, than any of the other Gospels. We also find that he is one of the best writers in the New Testament. His writing style is very engaging. It actually invites us into the story. And you will see that as we go on this journey together, that we're just, you're drawn into the story as he tells the life of Jesus Christ. I'd like to just read four verses for you right now and let Luke himself tell us why he took on this project of writing a biography of Jesus Christ. Luke 1, 1 through 4. Many have undertaken to draw up an account of the things that have been fulfilled among us, just as they were handed down to us by those who were the first, who from the first were eyewitnesses and servants of the word. With this in mind, I myself have carefully investigated everything from the beginning. I too decided to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, so that you may know the certainty of the things that you have been taught. Luke is writing this biography shortly after the life, death, resurrection of Jesus Christ. There's all kinds of eyewitnesses around, still living when he writes this, people he can talk to get his information. But there's also a lot of misinformation floating around because there's all kinds of buzz about Jesus going on in this day and age. Luke has a friend, we find out, named Theophilus, Greek name. Luke is a Greek. His friend Theophilus is also a Greek. He has a friend, and he cares enough about his friend to make sure his friend gets the truth about Jesus. Doesn't want him building his opinion on rumors or misinformation. So he says that I myself have carefully studied. I've dug into the details. I've looked for the facts. I've called out the fiction so that I can give you, my friend Theophilus, the most accurate picture possible of this man, Jesus Christ, why he came, what he did, how he wants to relate to us going forward. So Luke never wrote this to be published. He was never thinking of an audience hundreds and hundreds of years later looking at this personal letter that he wrote to a friend. But you and I are the beneficiaries of it today and all the hard work that Luke put into this particular biography. I believe that Luke acts as an investigative reporter as he approaches this project. He wants to get to the facts, he wants to get to the truth, and then he wants to present it in a very readable way. And let me just say that I believe Luke has something for each and every one of us. You may be somebody who walked in the door here today for the first time. Maybe you've not even been in a church before, and you know very little about Christianity, about the Bible, about Jesus. They're words to you, but you don't know how these all connect together. Luke has something for you here, because Luke starts at the beginning, and he'll tell you the background, and then the story of the life of Jesus Christ. Great place to start. Others of you who are here today, and I hear this story from time to time here at Metro, you got into a relationship with God way back when. High school, you were at a church retreat or something, and you said yes, and maybe then you kind of wandered away. And you've kind of turned your back on your faith for many years. And maybe just now you're starting to explore, what would it mean to come into an adult relationship with this God and with his son, Jesus Christ? Luke has something for you as well, because Luke will fill in a lot of gaps and maybe remind you of stuff that you've heard before but haven't paid much attention to for many years. And then there's others of us that we grew up in the church and we never necessarily went astray. And yeah, we get it, four Gospels, Luke, we kind of know where this is going. It's a familiar story to us. And there may be a tendency to think, yeah, I know that. I know that stuff. But let me tell you, after multiple decades in relationship with God and his word, I cannot approach this book. I cannot read two verses in this book without seeing something new, without God revealing to me something new that I hadn't seen before. And I can't tell you how many times I'll read something and then at the end I'll shake my head. It's like, where has that been? How did I miss that? Because you see, God is still active in this book, and he knows what we need, and he's revealing himself to us. So Luke literally has something for each and every one of us. So the invitation to join with us in this journey is there. Glad you're here today. Please stick with us. It's a great opportunity for us to all grow, learn, and journey together. Now, before I actually start reading, I want to give you a little disclaimer here. Luke, being this well-educated, sophisticated person, we know from another place in the New Testament that he's actually a medical doctor. He's a physician. Knowing all that, knowing his passion about the details, the facts, the truth, we might not expect him to be very comfortable with the supernatural, but he is. And we're going to run into it immediately today in this passage. We might think that Luke might say, well, you know, some of my readers, that might turn them off, and, you know, they might believe that's just, you know, just fantasy or whatever, so I'll leave those parts out. No. As he dug into it, he finds out that the supernatural is prevalent in the life of Jesus Christ. And so he has no problem talking to us about angels. He has no problem talking to us about miracles, about Jesus healing people with the touch of his hand, because he's investigated it and he knows those things actually did happen. And I believe Luke is very comfortable with the supernatural because he knows that his subject matter is God. And when you're dealing with God, there is no supernatural. Have you ever thought of that? We call it supernatural because from our perspective, it's above explanation. But from God's perspective, no, it's all the same. If you're all powerful, there is no supernatural. God can do whatever he wants. He can use angels to take messages. He can have people healed with a touch. He can cause old people to become pregnant, as we'll find out today. So if you're a bit skeptical when you run into the supernatural in the Word of God, let me just encourage you today to let God be God. Let God be who he is. We don't get to define God. That's not our job. God reveals himself to us, and he reveals to us as he reveals himself as this all-powerful God that has no problem doing what we call the miraculous. Okay? Don't let the supernatural turn you off in any way. I want you to turn to the person sitting next to you. I want you to take 30 seconds. Tell the person sitting, if you don't know the person, introduce yourself, but tell the person sitting next to you about one significant loss that you have experienced in your life. It could be a physical thing that you lost, or maybe you found it again later. It could be a relationship. It doesn't matter. Share with the person next to you one significant loss that you have experienced. 30 seconds, go. All right. First service was like half your size and twice as loud, so I don't know what the deal is with second service, but I hope you pulled it off, and if you only got halfway through your story, you can finish it after the service. We're going to meet a man right away as we open the Gospel of Luke today named Zechariah, and we find that he experiences a very significant loss, much more so than most of us have, and I know some of you have experienced serious losses. Zechariah's was life-changing for him, and we're going to see that right away as we open the Word of God. So I'm going to start reading today in Luke chapter 1, starting in verse 5. If those of you that read ahead, like we're asking you to do during this series, you already know what the loss was, but for the rest of us, we'll find out momentarily. Luke 1, verse 5. In the time of Herod, king of Judea, there was a priest named Zechariah, who belonged to the priestly division of Abijah, and his wife Elizabeth was also a descendant of Aaron. Both of them were righteous in the sight of God, observing all the Lord's commands and decrees blamelessly, but they were childless because Elizabeth was not able to conceive, and they were both very old. What Luke goes on to tell us was this priest, this man, Zechariah, he actually didn't work in Jerusalem at the temple, but they lived in a town out in the hills, small town. He was like the country preacher. He had his little parish there with his community. He had his synagogue where he taught and all. But every once in a while, the country priests were required to come into Jerusalem and lend a hand there in the temple. That's where we meet Zechariah and Elizabeth today. Zechariah had the privilege of being the one priest who got into the innermost part of the temple and was able to burn incense to the Lord. This happened once a year, one priest only. This was a huge deal for Zechariah. So he's in there burning incense, Luke tells us, and all of, and here comes the supernatural. Okay, spoiler alert, here comes. He's in there burning incense, thinks he's all alone, and then he realizes there's an angel next to him. Verse 11. Then an angel of the Lord appeared to him standing at the right side of the altar of incense. When Zechariah saw him, he was startled and was gripped with fear. But the angel said to him, "Do not be afraid, Zechariah. Your prayer has been heard. Your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you are to call him John. He will be a joy and delight to you, and many will rejoice because of his birth. For he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He's never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. He will bring back many of the people of Israel to the Lord their God, and he will go on before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elijah to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." Zechariah asked the angel, "How can I be sure of this? I'm an old man, and my wife is well along in years." Probably the wrong question to ask the angel. Didn't go well with Zechariah after that, because what we are told is that the angel says to Zechariah, "Dude, I'm on a mission from God. I'm bringing God's message to you, and you don't believe it. And because you don't believe it, you're going to lose your voice until the promise that God made has been fulfilled." And the promise was a son. Zechariah and Elizabeth were an infertile couple. They'd never had children. And in their old age, the promise from God is, you are going to have a kid. It's going to be a boy, and you're going to name him John. And Zechariah didn't believe it. And so the angel says, "You get 9 months to think about it. You're not going to talk." He didn't even get to negotiate with the angel, because his voice was gone, boom, immediately. Now think about that for a minute. I don't know what the primary thing is you use in your vocation, whether it's your keyboard or your screen or your car or whatever it is. But for Zechariah, the primary thing he used in his vocation was his mouth. Okay, most people were illiterate in that day. The priest was trained. He could read and write. He could open the Word of God and teach his people, and he did on a regular basis. Small groups, large groups, one-on-one, visiting people in his area, comforting the bereaved people, doing funerals and blessing babies. All that stuff that he did depended on his mouth. He could lose his leg and still be a priest. He could lose his eyesight and still be a priest, but he couldn't still be a priest without his voice. So when God took his voice away from him for those 9, 10 months, whatever it was, he took his occupation away from him. Serious loss for our friend Zechariah. Scripture goes on to tell us, Luke says, they went home from Jerusalem and Elizabeth got pregnant. And then we find out that 9 months later, the baby is born, and they name the baby John, as the angel said. We have recorded for us here in this first chapter of Luke the first words out of Zechariah's mouth after his 9 months of silence and solitude. I'm going to read for you starting in verse 67, and we get to hear Zechariah's response to the 9 months plus that he just spent thinking about what the angel said, thinking about what he knew from the Old Testament, and thinking about what he saw unfolding in front of him in real time. Verse 67, chapter 1. His father Zechariah was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he said through his holy prophets of long ago, salvation from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show mercy to our ancestors and to remember his holy covenant, the oath he swore to our father Abraham, to rescue us from the hand of our enemies, enable us to serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And I imagine Zechariah picking up the newborn infant John at this point. And you, my child, will be called a prophet of the Most High. For you will go on before the Lord to prepare the way for him, to give his people the knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, by which the rising sun will come to us from heaven, to shine on those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the path of peace. Church, in this passage, Zechariah's words is recorded for us by Luke and the episode with the angel. I want us to pull out today three things where God is revealing himself to us. Three things that he reveals to us about who he is and how he functions. There's more than that, but we don't have time to touch on more than that. I just want us to look at three things and then ask ourselves the questions, and how does that apply to my life? What does that say to me? The first one has to do with Zechariah's loss. And it's simply this, that in God's economy, loss does not always equal losing. In God's economy, loss does not always equal losing. As we see Zechariah and we understand the magnitude of his loss and the fact that he has no ability to function in his vocation for a significant period of time, we have to acknowledge that the loss for him was great. And he had choices at this point. He could shake his fist at God, and in his own heart, he could get bitter, all kinds of things that he could do. But what we see is he chose a different path. And he allowed that time of kind of mandated downtime for him to be the time when God worked in him and helped him connect all kinds of dots. That things that Zechariah himself had been teaching his people from the Old Testament, promises that God had made generations before, were now being fulfilled. And that even promises like a baby for him and his wife in their old age was being fulfilled as well. So Zechariah is thinking about all this, and he's considering what's going on, and he's watching what's happening to his wife, and he's realizing something very, very significant is happening right there in his own lifetime. And so the first words we hear out of Zechariah's mouth are not words of questioning God. God, how come so long? Couldn't I have learned this in 2 weeks? Why did you keep my voice away from me for all these months? No. None of that. The first words out of Zechariah's mouth are, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel." He comes out worshiping after 9 months of imposed silence. He comes out worshiping his God. So what's the application to us as we look at Zechariah, consider his loss, and consider how he handled it? I know for a fact that all of us in this room have experienced loss in our lives, some more significant than others. And I'm sure in your 30 seconds, you didn't bear the deepest part of your soul with each other, but you might have gotten a flavor for some loss that some of us have experienced. Sometimes losses that we experience are a result of bad choices that we make. And we get that. It's cause and effect. We can sort of connect the dots and say, yeah, I shouldn't have done that. And now because of it, I'm experiencing this loss. Okay, that happens, right? But then there's also this loss that happens that's completely out of left field. It's like, no idea where that came from. I didn't do anything to bring that on, but it happened nonetheless, and there is a loss and the resulting pain that I'm experiencing in my life. Now, whether your loss comes from one of those categories or the other, we still have the opportunity to experience what Zechariah did here in the book of Luke. We have the opportunity to get quiet before God and figure out, or allow God to let us know what's going on. Why did this happen? What do you want? Is there something I'm supposed to be learning in this? Did you take something away from me because I had put something in a place in my life that it shouldn't have been in? We take the time to allow God to speak to us and let us know why this particular loss. That's what Zechariah did, and his loss became great gain in his life, not only for him, but also for us, because of what's recorded for us here. Others of us have experienced great loss, either at our own hand or somebody else's maybe, and we've never moved on. We have actually allowed that loss to become our identity. We relive it on a regular basis like it happened yesterday. And that loss now defines who we are. That is called being stuck. Zechariah could have chosen that path, but he didn't. When we get stuck because of a loss, then the gain doesn't happen. We don't realize the benefits that can and should come in our lives if we are willing to look at God's perspective and God's bigger picture on it. The Apostle Paul was one of the prolific writers in the New Testament. He wrote most of the New Testament. And you may or may not know that he suffered incredible loss in his life. He was beaten multiple times. He was rejected by his own people. He had health issues. He was imprisoned completely unjustly. But listen to what the Apostle Paul says about the loss and suffering that he experienced. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16. Paul says this, "Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles, are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal." Notice how Paul defines his loss and his suffering. Light and momentary troubles. But he says that they are achieving for us an eternal glory that outweighs them all. Paul is seeing the gain on the other side of the loss. He's not choosing to live in the place of loss. He's choosing to live in the place of what God has done and is doing because of it. Church, we have a choice how we experience loss in our lives. We can face it with a raised fist and a stubborn heart, or we can actually receive it from God and do everything possible like Zechariah did to learn what the message or the lesson is that God has for us in the loss. That's the first thing that God reveals to us in this passage. The second one that I want us to look at today is simply this, that with God, a promise made is a promise kept. With God, every promise made will be fulfilled without fail. And we get a microcosm of that just in the story today, because as we look at these verses, we find out that that's played out over and over again. It starts off in verse 13 when the angel says to Zechariah, "You and your wife will have a son." Okay, there's a promise made. The angel was just delivering a message from God, a promise from God. Verse 24, Elizabeth gets pregnant. Verse 57, she gave birth to a son. So just in that short amount of time, promise made, promise kept. Verse 20, the angel says to Zechariah, "Okay, you didn't believe, that's cool. God's still going to keep his promise, but you don't get to speak until the baby's born." Promise made. Zechariah, no voice until the baby's born. Verse 64, the baby is born. Immediately his mouth was opened and his tongue set free, and he began praising God. Promise by God made, promise kept. And then in verse 70, as Zechariah is now recounting the things from the Old Testament, promises that God has made, he says this in verse 70. He says, "As God said through the prophets long ago." As God said through the prophets long ago. And what Zechariah is realizing here is the things that are happening are the very things that God promised long ago, and now God is fulfilling those promises. promise made is a promise kept when God's the one making the promise. None of us can say that about ourselves or anybody else we know, because we know we always fail in promises that we make. How does this apply to us? What can we take away from this truth about God? Well, as we see with Zechariah, God's track record is perfect. He doesn't miss anything of the promises made and promises kept in this passage. And we can look through Scripture and find the same thing is true. If God makes a promise, He is going to keep it. But God has promises that He has made to us, to you as individuals, to us as a church, that are still very, very active today. For example, God has promised us His presence. Okay, in the Old Testament, God said things like, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. Never is a pretty strong word, but He made good on it. In the New Testament, we see Jesus talking with His closest followers before Jesus is going to return to heaven, and He says to them, I will be with you always to the end of the age. Promise made. And then He goes on to say to them, but, you know, in bodily form, I'm going away, but we're going to send the Holy Spirit to you, and for every one of you that's a follower of me, He says, the Holy Spirit's going to live inside of you. And Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, is resident in each one of us. Promise made, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. I'm with you always to the end of the age, promise kept. And that He's keeping that promise to us today. Every one of us that's in a relationship with God through Jesus Christ has Jesus inside of us. Never left us alone. His presence is a promise that He has made. How do we live this out? Well, oftentimes we'll face a tough situation in life and we think God has abandoned us. I don't feel God's presence right now. Things aren't going the way that I wish they would. My prayers aren't being answered the way that I prayed them. And we think that God has moved away from us. If we're honest with ourselves, or if we talk to some people around us that might be looking at our situation, we might get a different perspective. It's like maybe we've kind of stepped away from God right now because we're sort of disappointed with Him. God hasn't moved away from us. He is present whether we feel it or not. And oftentimes after a difficult situation, we can look back and where we felt like God had abandoned us, we will recognize, oh no, He was there all along. Oh, look what He did for me. Look what He protected me from. Look what He provided for me for resources during that tough time. No, God was always there. He was always present. God makes a promise that He will always be present with us, and He is keeping that promise to this very day. Another example is God's love for us. If you were here last week when Linda was sharing with us, she talked about the love of God kind of being this foundational thing that we stand on that never shakes. Everything else is kind of built on the fact that God presents Himself to us as a God that loves us. And I know we all know that at one level. You know, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. But we kind of think that God retracts His love from us when we're not very lovable. You know, we screw up. How could God love me in the midst of that? You know, I sinned. It was rebellious. I know it. My bad. And we think that God will retract His love from us during those times. Exactly contrary to what's presented here in the Scripture. Because God Himself uses words like unfailing when He talks about His love. His love doesn't stop when we stop thinking we deserve His love. No, quite the contrary. His love for us is constant, unchanging, promise made, promise kept. The last thing I want us to look at today, final point, is that God presents Himself to us as a comprehensive Savior. A comprehensive Savior. Not my favorite word, comprehensive. Sounds a little too academic, but it's the best I could do because I want us to see that when God saves us, it is a complete package. There is nothing lacking. Everything is there. Now, Zechariah provides for us the details of what that means in this song, this poem that he has that I read for you a few moments ago. And I want us to look at those together and see what kind of a Savior God is portraying Himself to be. Remember that the angel said to Zechariah, I bring you this good news. The good news the angel was talking about was not the baby that was going to be born miraculously. Oh, that was good news for them. They prayed for that. It was a wonderful joy for their life. But that was a small portion of what the angel was talking about. Because as we see this unfold, we realize that the angel is talking about this promised Messiah from generations earlier that the people of God had been waiting for, hoping for, and praying for years had now arrived. Because you see, as we'll see next week, as we get into the rest of this story, Mary, the mother of Jesus, she came and lived with Zechariah and Elizabeth for the first few months of her pregnancy. Zechariah is living under the same roof as Mary, watching her belly grow, just a few months behind his own wife. Another miraculous birth is going to happen. But Zechariah now understands who this is that Mary is carrying, that God's plan for the ages, for saving humankind, is now happening. This is the good news that the angel's talking about. So here's how Zechariah defines this. In verse 68, he says, God has come to his people. God has shown up. We couldn't go to God because of our sinfulness, so God came to us. Most significant event in human history, the birth of Jesus Christ. God has come to his people. Also in verse 68, God has redeemed his people. God has taken all the mess, all the sin, all the things that kept us out of relationship with him. He's going to take care of those things so that we can come back into right relationship. God makes beauty out of ashes. He has redeemed his people. Verse 74, God has come to rescue us. Rescue means that he's come to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. If we could save ourselves, we would, but we can't. We're hopeless. We're helpless. So God has come to rescue us. Verse 77, salvation through the forgiveness of sins. Church, this was a game changer for those people in that day. They've been living under this Jewish religious system that said when you sin, you have to go to the temple and take an animal as a sacrifice. But that doesn't forgive the sin. It sort of covers it. It just sort of temporarily covers it. And the people of God had been looking ahead for generations towards God's final provision for forgiveness of sins. That was the Messiah. That was Jesus Christ. And Zechariah realized he has now provided for us salvation through the forgiveness of our sins. Forgiveness of sins is now possible. In verse 78 and 79, he talks about darkness changing to light. We were messed up. He realizes that. And now he talks about like the rising morning sun, that bright of a light eradicates the darkness. The Messiah's come. He's taken care of our needs. Verse 79, he says, God has brought us peace. And as a generation and as individuals, they hadn't experienced peace for a very, very long time. This is a complete package. This is a comprehensive Savior. This is how God presents himself to us. This is what God reveals to us about himself. So how do we apply this? What is the application? Well, first off, when the angel said to Zechariah that I bring you this good news, he was talking to Zechariah. But we're going to see a week or two from now the angel again talking to a group of people, some shepherds, after Jesus was born. And the angel says this good news is for all people. For all people. So first off, this salvation is not just for some subset of people or some ethnicity. No. This is for all of humanity. God's salvation that he has provided through Jesus Christ. It's for us. It's for everyone. So the question we need to ask ourselves is, number one, have we received it? God makes it available. He offers it to us as a gift because his son Jesus Christ did for us what we could never do for ourselves. Have we received it? Have we received the gift? And then the second follow-up question is, if the answer is yes, we've received it, then the question is, are we living into it? Are we living into this incredible salvation that God has made available to us? For some of us, it's a past experience. We can look back and we can, oh yeah, I made a decision and this, but it really doesn't have much impact on our life today. No, God's salvation for us is not just a past experience, it's a present reality. It changes the way we live our lives. It changes the way we make decisions. It changes the way we relate to people, what God has done for us. It's a comprehensive salvation that he makes available to us. So let me just summarize here in conclusion. This man Luke, he writes a biography of the life of Jesus Christ to a personal friend. We have our hands on it. This is a gift to us, church. This is a gift that we're going to receive over the next many months. Please stick with us for the journey and get all the benefits you can out of this gift that he has given to us. And just today, just in this one passage, we see God reveal himself in three distinct ways to us. First, he reveals himself to us as a God who loves us enough to turn our losses into gains, to turn our sorrow and our hurt into joy. He loves us that much. Second, we learn that God never fails to keep his promises. He hasn't failed yet. He's not going to start now. And we only talked about two of the promises he's made to us. There are multiple. We'll find more as we go through this book of Luke. And finally, God reveals himself to us as a comprehensive Savior. He leaves nothing undone in the package that he presents to us. He's done everything he needed to that we might be people that are redeemed, forgiven, because God has shown up. He's come to where we are. Let's pray together.